So I thought it was time for a bit of long overdue Land Rover maintenance. It's soldiered on through winter very well, but giving me a few signs that it needs a bit of attention. And the front brakes are getting a bit poor, and generally it's looking a bit grubby and in need of TLC under there. Also, there's a big build-up of dirt behind the mud shields, which I haven't had out since I put this footwell in, which is back in about 2014-15. So, mud shields out. Let's get out of the wind. Have a good old clean-up in there. And just generally a bit of a condition check. But pleasingly, you know, brake lines are good. There's no undue playing. Ball joints, wheel bearings feel good. And there's not brake fluid everywhere, so that's a start. But basically, today I'm going to have the mud shields out, have a good clean around, and then if I get time today, I'll take the brake drums off, inspect the brakes, and if that's all okay, I've got some Mayflower hubs that I want to fit in place of these OVMs. So I shall probably strip the hubs off, clean and re-grease, and fit the new three-wheel hubs. Sorry about the inevitable wind noise, not a lot I can do about that. Yeah, so there's the mud shield out. My repairs have held out and it's just needing a clean, I think. Maybe a lick of underseal. Nothing too horrible there, just a few bits of surface rust. We'll scrub that up. A few inaccessible bolts I can now get out and just check that are tight. But no. Let's have a look under the heater box, no rot under there, so no leaks. Yeah, so that could have been a lot worse, couldn't it? I reckon the other side might hide a few horrors actually, but usual steel and Burma bright not getting along. Anyway, nothing a bit of a clean won't sort out there. So the first side is all cleaned up, which is nice. I've a fairly thorough job and got right up in all the nooks and crannies, scrubbed the bodywork clean, just put a bit of underseal on where there's any paint that's come off, cleaned the springs and oiled them, had a really good go around the swivel units, just tried to scrub everything up, all the fixings, so that I can get them undone at some stage. Just got the, if I show you, the inner wing off the offside, which was considerably worse actually. Get some light on the subject. So yeah, it's all a bit grassy up in here. You might remember the steering box video, so that's going to get fitted at some point. This one's actually still very good, but just need to clean, as you can see, and a little bit leaky. I'll check and top it up while I can get to the bung easily. Yeah, not too bad in here. I was expecting all sorts of horrors from what I could see looking in the top, but it's very good. Pleasingly up around the brake master tower, that's all good. No leaks apparent. So yeah, just more grotty cleaning to do really. Worth doing though. Oh, and just for comparison. So that's how the other side was. It's taken an hour or so, but again, worth doing. So here we are, all cleaned up this side as well. Looking very much better. Cleaned up really well. In fact, there's no need to re-underseal any of it. It's very good. I've been able to have a proper look at the seal bracket on that bulkhead foot. I'm going to have to do something about that soon. So that will be the next big job. Anyway, decided not to go mad with the mud shields for now, under-sealing them. You can get galvanised replacements now. So I mean, this one's been repaired, all of that is new. It's kind of a funny story to that, but I can get some galvanised ones at some time. But when I did all that work years ago, it was quite hard up at the time. And I seem to remember that bit of steel is the back of a filing cabinet in the workshop office at the time. So I hope no one's ever tried to move it. So there's a useful trick before you put the mud shield on. Put some nuts on the bolts first. Makes it much easier to fit, but also actually creates a gap behind the mud shield and between the footwell. And you can simply get a hose in behind and wash all the muck out. And that's a sort of wet to go. So tomorrow I will have a look at the hubs and the brakes. Well, hello again, we're going to do some more Land Rover maintenance today. I'm going to start with the front axle oils. I'm going to drop the swivel oils and the diff oil and refill. I've now got this fantastic piece of kit which I picked up at an auto jumble last year and restored mechanically, and it just makes the job so easy. I used to faff about underneath with oil cans trying to top up the swivels and what have you. This is the proper way to do it. And don't go out and pay 200 quid for a new plastic one. Go to an auto jumble and you'll find something like this. It'll last forever. I'm going to have the hubs off today, hopefully, as well, the front hubs. I want to take the bearings out and repack them with grease. Just make sure it's all nice and clean in there and what have you. And then I'm going to reset the end floats on the hubs. Important that that's right. At the moment there's some AVM hubs fitted. I started out with some worn freewheel hubs, American Warns, but I didn't like them. They were very leaky and they looked nice, but you couldn't really get all the bits for them. I've then got some AVMs. I've had them for probably 4 or 5 years now, and they've been really good, but they don't seem to fare very well with the weather. They're really rusty and corroded and horrible, and I don't really like the Torx drive screws in the end or the plastic dial to operate them. You won't get the Torx drive screws out when you really need to, and the plastic dial will probably break sometime when I need it. They're also not that hard wearing. They've got a bearing inside which doesn't fare very well on late. It's a needle roller bearing, doesn't fare very well on late Series 3s, which have a lot less lubrication to the axle. To the actual hubs, I should say. Post 1980, the hub design was changed. Early Series Land Rovers, Series 2s, 2As, they had oil lubrication to the hubs. But post 1980, the Land Rover hubs got redesigned with different seals and so on. So the front hubs on a Series 3 tend to rely just on grease. Now, to that end, I've got these Mayflower freewheeling hubs. I wanted a set of these for a very long time. Now, they turn up all the time, but not these 24 spline ones. These are really quite rare. And I restored them over Christmas, and they really came up quite nicely. So these are ready to fit now. But it was pretty well apparent when I got them as to why these hubs are so rare, and that is that the running clearance of the rotor in the aluminium housing was just tiny. We're talking a couple of thousandths clearance. So as soon as that bronze bush in there develops a little bit of wear, and the hardened rotor in the centre gets a bit of side play going on, it starts to eat the housing, and that's when you hear the clicking. Because these hubs are known for ticking when they go faulty. So I put the hub bodies up in the lathe, and I've just increased the housing rotor clearance by about 10 thou. So they can't do that. So that they will tolerate a little bit of play in the bushing. So it will be a case of taking them off probably once a year, packing them with grease, and just a bit of maintenance. But they're a really sturdy thing, very much more so than the the AVMs and the Warns, and you see that he's on all the Expedition equipped Land Rovers, so I'm much happier fitting them. Not that I'll do anything like that with my Land Rover anytime soon, but it's just nice to know that they're a solid bit of engineering. Also made this half shaft nut spanner in the course of the project. I made that on the little Warco milling machine, which you probably haven't seen. Cracking little piece of kit, and I thoroughly recommend one. You hear so much bad stuff about mini mills, but these, with a few subtle mods, can be a really, really useful machine. It's very accurate. Easily work within a half a thou over the length of the bed for a bit of careful setting up. Anyway, so that's what I'm intending to do today. I've got a list to go through. Just while talking about Christmas restorations, that was another one I did over Christmas, a fairy capstan winch, which was in a very bad way. I had to make lots of parts for the drive line and so on. I actually sold that towards the MGB in the end, but I was really hoping to fit that and these hubs, but can't have it all. Anyway, so there's those two hubs, and hopefully I'll get them on today. Okay, so we're just checking the front offside brake while the near side is draining. Now, I had a problem a few years ago with the front brakes, whereby the adjuster pins work loose on the shoes, and that is a common problem with a certain batch of Mintex brake shoes about 5 or 6 years ago. And these happen to be part of the affected batch, so I've now welded in all my adjuster pins. But I hear that Mintex shoes are absolutely fine, and I wouldn't hesitate to buy another set now. It was just a temporary problem. So we've got two wheel cylinders on the front axle of a long wheelbase Land Rover. No oil and grease all around here, which is nice. I've already had the boot off that one. It's just grease in there, but no fluid leaks. Should be a bit of grease. And again, the top is fine. Rubber grease, but no leaks. So checking around the back of the hub, there's not oil or grease all coming out of there, so I'm happy that the seal is okay. And looking at the shoes, what we're looking for is any big cracks. It's quite common to see little hairline cracks, and we've got a few going on here. And that's just generally down to heavy dirt getting in there at some time or another. But they're quite serviceable. The minimum lining thickness should be 1/32 of an inch with these bonded shoes. The riveted type on earlier models is quite different. So, no problems there. I did also have another problem 2 years ago where the bottom wheel cylinder seized and the brakes were still working quite well, but the vehicle was pulling to the left. But it seems that the wheel cylinders are fine. They've been moving, I can see them. And what I'll do later on, I'll slacken the adjusters right off and just make sure that the shoes pull in, and that shows me that the cylinders are moving freely. The drum looks very nice. Just very light scoring, as you'd expect. There's about 40, 45,000 miles on these and the shoes now. But really very little wear, and all looks good. Later on I'll go through adjusting the brakes. There was a technical service bulletin issued in the 80s for serious Land Rovers. People were having trouble getting a good pedal on long wheelbase models. That's partly due to the terrible design of the two wheel cylinders. The bleed nipple for the bottom cylinder is right underneath. That makes it rather difficult. But there is a particular way to adjust these to get a really good pedal, so I'll show you that later on. So for now, I'll have the hub off and get everything cleaned up. Alright, so it's going to take a little while to drain this side, so I'm going to get on and take the drum off. I'm a little bit concerned about this deposit here that's come out of the drain holes in the drum. So I need to have a look and see what's going on. To get these off, if the brakes are really well adjusted up, you'll need to slacken the adjusters off. Now, if we just manoeuvre behind with the camera. On a longer base, you'll see that there's one just down this side with a sort of double Thackeray washer on it. And then there's another one just down there. I'll try and show them a bit better when I adjust the brakes later on. And then you'll need to remove that screw there. And for that, an impact driver is generally useful. I keep them well copper slipped, so never usually any issues. If the brakes haven't been adjusted so recently, the drum should come straight off. So not looking too bad this side. I think the winter muck hasn't been so kind to this side. It's all very dirty, and there is a bit more of the hairline cracking of the brake shoe. Not concerned about it at the moment. It's fairly normal to see that, and it's just caused by dirt ingress. But that's something to keep an eye on. Generally, they've worn quite evenly, so that's fairly good. They're not all greasy. Just had the seals off both wheel cylinders and they're looking good. The adjuster pins are okay and the springs are alright. Again, the hub isn't all greasy, so again in fairly good shape, just needing a clean. I'd say one of the shoes has been dragging slightly this side at some time, but it's not too bad. Just a little bit of a clean required, that's all. Well, the wind's getting stupid now, so I hope you can hear me. Anyway, got the front hub off on the offside. Looks pretty good in there. The hub's obviously got oily inside, but it does happen over time. Oil does migrate up the half shaft. But you don't get quite so much as with the earlier Land Rovers. The free wheel hub was a pain to get apart. These little Torx things are horrible, and of course they sit on a taper, so they're easy to tighten. You need more torque to get them undone, so it seems anyway. Nightmare. But I had to drill some of the bolts out in the end. So these are now scrap. It's a real battle. I might see how far I can drop kick that. Some time ago I made a special socket for fitting and removing the AVMs. You don't get that supplied, and I don't know if you can buy it. But it served me well. So I'm now going to get the other side off. I'll clean everything up together, probably paint the hubs. And then while the paint dries, I'll come back and clean all this up. So the second hub came off. Easier. Well, we've still got the base of it to get off, but all those screws out okay. Yeah, a bit of moisture got in there, and a bit of wear in the bearing as well. These have got about 30,000 miles on them, maybe a little less. Anyway, good opportunity to clean all that up. The near side hub off. I mentioned earlier I thought that the hubs were a little tight after a bit more experience of setting them, and the front ones always got just slightly warm to the touch. They should really stay cold, and you can see here that the inner races have spun at some point. They haven't actually severely damaged the shaft, but you can see that they have actually spun on the shaft, which is not good news at all. So fortunately I can feel the shaft is okay, and obviously I'll check it properly. But that's why it's very important to have the correct end float on your hubs and not just set them by feel. Get yourself a dial gauge and do it properly. Anyway, as I say, the stub axle looks okay. These are all one piece on these later post 1980 Series 3 vehicles. Okay, so I'm just about to start cleaning the hubs up. I was hoping to get these old seals out and reuse them because they're absolutely fine. However, I put them in with a sealant, which isn't strictly necessary, but you can do that. So it is going to be a case of probably ruining them to get them out. It just so happens that I've got a couple of spares which should be usable. Now, I just wanted to clear something up really. People are always commenting on my Land Rover wheel bearing video that the seals are installed incorrectly. They're not, they're quite correct. After 1980, the seals changed. Around 1980, as I've mentioned several times today, there was a what they termed an axle rationalisation program, where they tried to share more components across the different models. And the hub seals were one of the items that changed. So you no longer had a separate collar on the axle shaft, the stow axle. The stow axle became one piece, and a different seal was installed. So normally, yes, the seal would be round the other way. But on these later models, this is quite correct, with the kind of lip facing outwards. Alright, so I've just got the hubs painted. I stripped them, degreased them. Seals actually came out easy enough in the end, but I'm going to replace them as I've got new ones. And yeah, everything is degreased. The bearings are bagged up. So near side front, near side rear, etc. Just so they go back exactly as they were. And the half nuts and so on are all ready to go on. I've also degreased all the plugs and fixings, everything, so all the threads are nice and clean. Yeah, just got these painted in time. Next door I've just started doing the rabbit hutch, so with the wind it's like a sort of tornado of hay out there at the moment. So I'm going to go and have my lunch while they dry. I've got the brake back plates to wash, I've got the oils to change, so by the time I've done all that, should be able to press the seals into those and get them refitted. Okay, so I've got in there with lots of bright cleaner and the paintbrush. Just knocked off as much dirt as I can, so despite appearances it is quite clean now, particularly the shoes, so it's all ready for when the hubs are ready to go back on. Right, so it's really important that the bearings go back where they were in the hubs if you're just taking them out cleaning and greasing like I am. To pack wheel bearings you just want to get a big blob of grease on your hand and work it into the bearing, drag the bearing across your hand through the grease, pushing the grease through the bearing from one direction. You don't want to do it from both sides, from one side, because then you don't end up with any air in it and it's fully packed with grease. It doesn't actually need to be, the hub doesn't have to be packed right up with grease, just as long as the bearing is full, that will see it right for its useful life. So that bearing is now fully packed, you can see the rollers are completely packed solid with grease, and I'm going to press the sealing. And if you're pressing seals in hubs, it's really useful to have an old wheel bearing, put a slot in it with an angle grinder, and you can then use it for driving in the new bearing races as well. But I use that for pressing in the new seals, pop it on top of the seal, block of wood, and knock it in with a hammer. Should go in nice and square. So if you have a Haynes manual, if you look in the back, assuming it's a more recent manual, supplements, revisions and information on later models, you'll find information on the axle rationalisation and modification 1980 on. So for late Series 3 vehicles you need to refer to this. And it gives a nice diagram of all the components you should find in a late axle. And a bit of detail about the seals as well. And it tells you that you should recess the seal in the housing 4.8 to 5.3 millimetres. Now, I'm never quite entirely sure with these where you should measure, because there's a lip there, but I tend to measure off the flat. If you can just see that bit there. And that has always worked for me, about 5 mil from there which these are. This one is, and that should be okay. So the next thing I'll do is just pack a little bit of grease in there, put the bearing in the other side, and it's ready to fit. So there we have it, a pair of axle hubs ready to fit. I should explain that I haven't really said anything about inspecting the bearings. These bearings have probably got 30k on them, but there's nothing wrong with them there. Obviously you can see that they've been running, but they certainly don't warrant replacement yet. They were fairly expensive Timken ones I fitted about 4 or 5 years ago, and yeah, they're wearing well. But then I've kept up with the maintenance. But what you are looking for is any corrugations in the bearing race. So the outer part, you want to have a look. I didn't really explain any more about the corrugations. You'll know if they're corrugated, because you'll hear it. But it's worth having a good look at. Brunelling is the proper term, I think. But anyway, that's what tends to happen when they're worn. Both of these are fine, so I'm going to get these fitted to the vehicle. Incidentally, people are always slagging off Brickpart. I've never had a problem with their hub seals. It's more down to how you fit them. Fit them properly, maintain things, and you won't have any issues. Where I will spend some money is things like those bearings. So they are Timken ones. Anyway, we'll go and pop those on and set the end floats. Okay, so now I'm setting up the end float on the hub. When I fit the hub on the axle, I just fit the inner lock nut to start with. There's like a kind of keyed washer, then the lock nut goes on. All you need to tighten those up is one of these box spanners, and I like to use a 1 foot Tommy bar, more than sufficient. I then lock the inner nut up as hard as I can and rotate the hub with the bearings quite tight, and that settles everything, forces the grease to where it wants to sit. You can then fit the lock washer, which has got again a tang that goes in that keyway, and then fit the outer nut. Now as you tighten that outer nut, the clearance will reduce, the inflow will reduce because of the clearance on the thread, just the nature of what it is. So you nip the outer nut up and it all tightens up again. So it's very much a feel thing. When you put the inner nut on and you've settled the bearings, you'll get to know how much to turn it back before you fit the lock washer in the nut. And in this case I was at 5 thou with my usual setting. The hub end float on a later Series 3 like this, post 1980, is 2 to 4 thousandths of an inch. So I've got the mag base DTI on the hub and on the half shaft, which is about the best I can do. You need to pull the hub back and forth with both hands, obviously, to keep it square, because end float obviously relates to side play. So I've just adjusted this up again. I've now got to 2 1/2 thousandths end float, so I'm going to leave it there. As I say, you don't need to go mad locking up these nuts. You just use the box spanner and a Tommy bar and then fold the tabs over. So that's it for today. Losing the light and it's blooming cold, so that is the first of the Mayflower hubs on. I've torqued up 30 lb foot. It's always the bit that makes me twitchy, but no problems, torqued up just fine. I've just cleaned the excess sealant away that oozed out, and I've checked for operation. It's all been between free and fixed while turning the hub. That's all good. Not going to rush and try and do the other side tonight. I'll just do it in the morning. So I'm quite pleased with that. Okay, so the offside hub is now fitted, and the free wheel hub is fitted too. Nothing too fitting them really. I was going to film putting them on, but the camera ran out of battery and a hailstorm came over and so on, so not ideal, but fairly easy to fit. I use Weld Seal on the gaskets so I can get them off if I need to without destroying the gaskets. There's a split pin in the castle nut on the half shaft, which is kind of hard to get in, but it can be done. Yeah, not a lot to it really, just making sure that the two halves line up properly, and I got as much grease around them as I could. These 24 spline ones, I haven't been able to find a manual relating to these, only the ones for 10 spline axles. Now on the end of the half shaft there is a felt and rubber washer which you use with free wheel hubs on Land Rovers. I believe the idea is to stop oil migrating up the sub axle and into the hub. On these anyway, you've got an intermediate half shaft seal down in there, but that's just an extra. I nicked the ones out of the old AVMs for that, and they fitted perfectly. So hopefully that's correct. If anyone knows different, let me know. But certainly the usual spacer washer and castle nut wouldn't fit, but the castle nut and seal were perfect. Anyway, I've now locked the brakes up. I'm going to adjust the brakes. I mentioned previously that I'd found a service bulletin on getting a good pedal on Series 3 Land Rovers, particularly these twin leading shoe front brakes. I'm only going to adjust the front brakes today because I'm going to look at the back axle soon, but I want to just show you the method described in this bulletin. So if we go around to the cab, found another use for the old beer crate, and I've wedged the brake pedal hard down. Normally when I set my brakes, what I do is I get in and I pump the pedal a couple of times to try and centralise the brake shoes, but realistically this method described in the service bulletin, albeit not a beer crate, the service bulletin suggests that you get a helper to sit in the cab of the vehicle and put their foot hard on the brake, and you should then tighten up the brake adjusters hard against the drums. You then release the foot off the pedal, and then you slacken the adjusters off a click at a time until the wheel just turns freely, and that should get you a much better pedal. So we'll give it a go. So I said I'd try and show you the brake adjusters. You can just see one of them there to the left of the brake line. And the other one is there, just behind the filler plug for the swivel unit. Three clicks off with this one on each adjuster. Okay, so it's very much better. You expect a bit of free play on the pedal, but these long wheel base series 3s are notorious for having a bad brake pedal. front end completed, everything torqued up. All seems happy enough. I'm certainly pleased with it. And I've just made a start on the back end, so it's jacked up on stands. And I've got under there with wire brushes and what have you, and giving it all as good a scrub as I can, getting right up in the bodywork and all the cavities, and getting as much dirt as I can out of there while rushing the exhaust. I think that one's managed two winters this time, so definitely going to go to a stainless one soon enough. Anyway, been over the springs, giving them a good clean, the axles, everything. I couldn't believe how much muck came off it. Definitely worse this end than the front. I might actually spread some underseal around on the body at the end of the week, once it's all dried out. Anyway, there you go, so that really is it for today. So that's pretty much it for today. I've got under there both sides with a wire brush, got rid of as much muck as I can possibly scrub away. Haven't found any horrors, and just hosed it all down. Giving the springs a good wash all around the axles, brake back plates and so on. So I've been and ordered up the seals and so on that I need for the rear hubs, so they're going to get exactly the same treatment. I won't film that because it's going to be much the same thing. Anyway, I've been wanting to do that for ages, so worth getting stuck in.